This is a not comprehensive review of tracheostomy, but very few slides just to give you tips about what you need to know about tracheostomy as internal medicine resident. So the site of trach, we do it between second and third or third and fourth tracheal cartilage. If it's too high, it can cause some degree of subglottic stenosis. If it's too low, it can lead to bleeding from the brachiocephalic trunk. Timing of the trach in medical ICU patients, usually we consider the trach if we think the patient will not be able to be extubated within 14 days. It's different between patient population group. For example, trauma patients, they may do the trach earlier because of facial trauma, or they are expecting very long recovery for the patient. So here I'm talking about medical ICU patients. There was a recent trial, TrachMan trial in 2013. There was no difference in outcomes between early and late tracheostomy for medical ICU patients. After that, there is a meta-analysis came out showing maybe there is a benefit, but as for now, with the practice, if you expect the patient to be on the ventilator more than 14 days, you can do tracheostomy, considering other factors as well. That's how we do the trach on the bedside by dilation tracheostomy, and we do it with bronchoscopic guiding. You have to know cuff pressure. It should be adjusted. Don't use too much pressure. Otherwise, this may cause impairment of the blood flow to the mucosa, and that can present later with some degree of stenosis. And don't keep the cuff too loose. Otherwise, that cuff may develop some folds, and that can lead to some degree of microaspiration. This is a trach maybe you're familiar with. So this is an obturator. This is a tracheostomy tube, which is plastic tube or chyle. We use it here in patients. And this is the inner cannula. So with the chyle or plastic tube, you can change it every 60 to 90 days. Some manufacturers recommend earlier change of the tube. And I'm mentioning this point because we have another kind of tubes, which is a metal tube, and it can be left for forever and life long. When you change the trach, you put the obturator inside the tracheostomy tube, you put some gel, you put the patient in a supine position, some degree of hyperextension of the neck, and you put some gel here, and then you move the older tube, and then you put the other tube, which is the new one. Don't use force. If you met by resistance, don't ever use force. Otherwise, you may create a false tract, can go into the mediastinum, and you can have a complication. This is the inner cannula, which when the patient is receiving mechanical ventilation, this inner cannula goes inside the tracheostomy tube, and the ventilator is connected here. When you are not ventilating, the inner cannula comes out, and the patient can just use the tracheostomy tube. Another type of tube, which is the Jackson metal, maybe some of you saw it. So this tube, it has silver coating. Silver coating is non-irritant, it's bactericidal, and this can last for longer period, lifetime, especially with the patient who will need permanent tracheostomy. They have cancers, they have degree of obstruction that cannot be treated. So usually these patients, we use the metal Jackson tube. It will be confusing for you if you have a patient with Jackson metal tube and the patient needs intubation on the floor and you don't know what you should do. Should you intubate the patient? Should you change it? What should you do in this situation? Ideally, it should be changed to another cuffed tube which has a cuff so you can connect to the ventilator and ventilate. But if there is an emergency situation, you can get a universal connector which is 15 millimeter and you can insert it into the Jackson tube, and at least you can ventilate the patient till you call the fellow or the attending and, you know, see what's happening. But in emergency situation, if you need to provide ventilation, you can ask the respiratory therapist to provide you with a plastic connector, and you can just put it there, hook the patient to the ventilator. Of course, there will be a leak because there is no cuff, but at least there is some degree of ventilation happening in emergent situation. And then this can be changed later to a plastic chyle tube with cuff. These are the diameters of the tube. Usually we use anywhere between 6 and 8. The internal diameter is very close to the number. The chyle catheter will have the number written, so you should know what size you have, especially if you are going to change it. You should use the same size. Tube change, I'm not talking about routine tube change, but I'm talking about if you have a certain emergency or situation, you have to know that when your trach was inserted. Because if you change the tube too soon, you may be at higher risk to create a forced trach. The trach is not well formed between the skin and the trachea. And usually we wait anywhere between 7 to 14 days. They did some clinical trials, did some questionnaires for ENT chief residents, and the time was 5.3 days. Other study connected were conducted and showed probably we should wait longer. But here, anywhere between 7 and 14 days would be enough to have the trach formed. If you remember, the number 7 to 14 or 7 to 10 is the amount required to form a trach or for the stoma to close. So if you remove the tracheostomy tube, you should expect this to close in the same amount of time. So you have to be familiar about that, because if the tube, the tracheostomy tube came out and the patient just had the procedure 2 days ago, you should be more careful than changing of a trach has been there for like weeks. Because if you put it and you create a wrong trach, it may just go into the mediastinum and you start ventilating and you will have pneumomediastinum and the patient may, and there are cases which happened like this. And especially if you use excessive force. Also, you may read XLT, and or you had a patient, and the RT will tell you, oh, the patient has XLT. Shiley, what's XLT stands for? It's extended length tube. This is the diagram of the tube. We have a distal portion, and we have proximal portion. So XLT, it can come in two forms, proximal and distal. So in case of proximal XLT, usually we use it for patients with a large neck, obese individual. So you have this portion is longer, so it can reach the trachea. The distal XLT tube, this part here, which is the distal part, is the longer part. And usually we use it for cases of tracheomalacia or if you have obstruction to bypass that area. So that's what it means, XLT, especially if the trach comes out and you need to change it and you ask for a trach, you have to know, is it shiny, is it regular, or XLT? And if it's XLT, is it proximal or distal? If the patient is obese, probably it will be a proximal XLT shiny catheter that you need to order. If there's issues with obstruction or tracheomalacia, probably it's a distal trach. Another thing we see, the valve, the speaking valve, some patients use it. Just you have to be familiar with the mechanism. That's the valve. It goes over the tracheostomy. The way it acts is you inhale the air, and it's a one-way valve. So when you exhale, it can pass through the vocal cords, and then you can vocalize and talk. So it's a one-way valve. That's the way it works. And the other thing is, remember when you should deflate the cuff in a patient with tracheostomy. So if you put a patient on a TPS trial in the ICU, you're trying to extubate a patient who has a trach and you put him on the TPS, see how he's doing, you should deflate the cuff. Because if the cuff is inflated and the TPS become obstructed, there is no airway. So you have to remember to deflate the cuff. That's very important. Also, be prepared if you are changing a trach. Probably it's a straightforward procedure, especially if it has been there for a long time, but you have to be careful. It's an airway. Any dealing with airway, you have to put other plans. You have to have intubation kit available. You have to have a bougie. You have to have a small endotracheal tube to help you with airway in case of emergency. Because if you cannot get an airway, you may just go ahead and intubate the patient and then try to see what you will do or get a bronchoscopy or help. But at least you'll be able to provide some oxygenation. Small tubes, size 6 endotracheal tube, sometimes in case of emergency, if you have the stoma there and you cannot insert the tube, you can put a bougie without resistance, and then you can slide endotracheal tube inside the stoma over the bougie, which is size 6, confirm your position with carbon dioxide monitor, and then try to get some help and see what's happening. So at least know these things when you do it. Have an intubation kit there. Know your Shiley catheter, what type, for how long it has been there, because changing a Shiley which has been there for 2 days different than another trach has been there for weeks. Know what size. Sometimes if you cannot insert the same size, you can use a smaller tracheostomy to put and get an airway. Also, know when you deflate your tube cuff, if you decide, especially TPs, or if you decide to cap the trach, don't keep your cuff open and then close the trach. And know your position when you change the trach, and be aware about risk of formation of a false trach, especially if you are replacing a fresh trach. Also, don't use any force whatsoever if you are doing tube change and you met by resistance, and always be prepared for emergency. Have a smaller size tube there, have intubation kit, RT with you, so any dealing with airway, either during intubation or trach management, you have to be prepared. Because in this situation, if you lose the airway, desaturation, emergency situation, you will not have time to go look for intubation kit, and this can be a life-threatening. And finally, ask for help. We are here. I mean, you can call us. We can be there to help you and provide supervision and such. Okay? Thank you.